card. Yeah. Okay. So every time you can pause it.
Okay. I'm not going to do it. So I started?
Yes, started.
All right.
And double check. Yeah.
Share. All right, let's get him started.
All right. By the way, we're doing recording, okay? We're testing it. It looks fine at this moment. And it can die at any time. So just still try not to fall into sleep or anything like that. But we're doing the recording, simply trying to making sure that if you are out of town and for certain classes, and you can still have the opportunity to revisit. Okay? And we'll figure out how to distribute that as well. And it's not going to be very easy. All right, so now let's come back and drill down individual sequencer technologies to see why they're sequencing that fast. I'm going to spend most of my time on the Illumina sequencing because this is a such important technology that you need to know, especially for the students in the School of Informatics. And I'm pretty sure at a certain point you are looking for some job. And for any of those, if you're related, working in this related area, it's very possible that they will ask you some of the specifics, and that's why I want to go into details about this. Okay? So what we have in the Illumina sequencer for our school is HiSeq 4000. But in general, the protocol is very similar. It's across all their product lines. And for our specific machine, we can run two flow cells at a time. I have that. All right. So this is the flow cell. Okay. So this is the flow cell. I will pass it around. But if you see, there's eight kind of lengths, and each length is a separate experimental unit. Okay. And each lane will give you about 330 million sequencing reads. Okay, I know this is art over hat, whatever it means, right? I don't really know. And sometimes we really got over 400 million reads in each lane. So their specs are pretty conservative. And if I use a more flashy term, you can think of each lane. So for this whole thing is equivalent to 2.5 billion standard sequencers, the throughput. And this is really amazing. You can pass around and this is already being used. So don't be afraid to damage it, but I still want it back. Right. Actually, we have plenty. So you have different options. You can run anywhere from 36 base to 250 base. And for some of the instruments, they can go as long as 250 bases. Our instrument can only go 150. And there's a single end option or paired end option. Sequence one end or sequencing from both two ends. And these are the specs. And there's a concept of multiplexing. And what that means is we know that these sequencers generate so many reads that we do not need for one single sample. For example, for RNA sequencing, usually we only do about 30 million reads per sample. So which means you can really sequence about 12 samples in one lane. And so we can do the barcoding to do the multiplexing to merge multiple samples in one lane to do the experiment. Okay, so now let's get to the biochemistry part to see why that is sequencing that fast. So just follow me tightly, because if you blink your eyes and something goes on, and then you probably won't be able to follow, all right? And I'm not very good at explaining that, so I will warn you, okay? So you can see, by the way, all the figures are from their manufacturer website a couple of years ago, all right? So you see that there is a couple of different colors here, and each one corresponding to one nucleotide. And the green one are the ones that you want to sequence, and we don't know what their sequence are, okay? And this dark or light purple ones, and those are the adapter sequences. Okay, so those adapters are being provided by Illumina as a part of the reaction. So what you do is you mix this and this together. You mix them together, and then using the ligation assays, by the end of the day, the product looks like this. You have your sequence you want, the nucleotide you want to sequence, put the adapter at the end. Okay, so this is what the technician do actually in the lab to do this called library preparation, okay, or library instruction. So if you know that people are talking about library instruction, that is what they do. It's more difficult than this because I mean, the DNA is not ready to be sequenced, that you have to convert from RNA to DNA or do the purification. There's many different steps, but by the end of it, this is the product to be sequenced. And then for this product, the next step they do is to put on this flat surface. So you can see these are our flow cells, if you will. Okay, you can just imagine that that is a glass. Okay, it's not, but just imagine it's a glass. So when you randomly distribute all these molecules, so you can see there's some of them has this the metal insert which is being more interested, others just have adapters. When you put it on that, and then these are going to be, they have chemical reactions making sure that they're going to stand on this glass surface. So there's a, you can see that there is a many different long grass, like adapters, together with a few trees that represent different DNA molecules you want to sequence. Okay, just dumping it there. Okay, so the next part is to do something called a bridge amplification. So what happens is that you see, but using this as an example, standing there as a tree, and it is bended, form this bridge. So this part is going to be reverse hybridized to this part of the adapter. And this is called the bridge part. Okay. I was very curious, asked the sales to say, how did you make it bend? And they said it's different. So they didn't tell me. Right? And I'm pretty sure they have some reason for that. Right. And the next stage is going to be using that as a reverse, DNA polymerase regular reaction. So you can see this one become used. Starting from one strand, but this part is being served as a primer, and then here is you basically amplify it. You make one copy into two. Okay. And next step, making them stand. Okay. So at this reaction, after this, you can see that initially I have four trees among this grass. Now I have eight trees, which each pair is upside and down, right? It's upside down tree, okay? But they are identical in terms of sequence, except they are upside down. That's all only difference. And then you do this reaction again. So making both of them form the bridge and then do the nucleotide extension. And then so one become two, two become four, four become eight. And if you do this many, many times, and then you will see that originally that was a one tree, now become a forest. So that's all what it's named. So this whole part is called a bridge amplification, right? So I'm putting it here. So for the second generation sequencing, there are two major components when you do the sequencing. One is to amplify the signals. And Illumina used bridge amplification. I will talk about another one called emotion PCR that was used by our technologies. Okay, so this is the amplification part. The reason for that is we need to amplify one trait, one DNA molecule. We cannot get enough signal to detect. But once you get 30,000 of the same trait from the forest, and you will be able to. Okay. So now let's talk about the sequencing part. How do we do the sequencing, right? So you can see that those trees are already still standing there, okay? Except for the upside down one, and they get rid of it. It's a very simple reaction. You just release those adapters that we found. And so those are the identical trees now, okay? And then what they do is, that's why I went through briefly about the summary sequencing. Now what you do is you throw in these colored circles, and those are actually the label, very similar to the label the DE and TP. and so with two differences. So the first one is that actually it's not BDNTP, it's the regular BNTP, but they put a stopper at towards the end of this OH group, right? So it's just that the reaction cannot further go, okay? But it's a stopper, it's not a changing an OH to an H, it's not a BDNTP. The second change is they actually color label that. So they put another fluorescent label, so you can see that A, C, G, T, they all representing different colors, okay? So those are BNTP, they put a stopper, and then they put a color. That's the two things they did, all right? So the when they do the reaction, they throw all those different colors and the BNTPs here. And you can see for this part, and the template is an A, and that's why the T is going to be put in here, right? And the reverse complement to that, so the polymerase is going to happen. So you can see that there's a lot of green thing around here. And here is there's a lot of red, and there's a lot of blue, and there's a lot of yellow here. And that is simply because of what is the next nucleotide on this template you want to sequence. As I mentioned, they have a stopper there, so you cannot go further. You just stop, just one base extension, okay? So at this stage, if one day all this reaction happened, you take a picture of the slides that I just showed you. You take a picture of that. And then you will figure out, oh, here's a big green dot. Here is a big yellow dot. So basically, by reading those colors, I mean, of course, they have software to do that. And you are able to detect whether for all the templates, the next base is an A, C, G, or T. That makes sense? Okay, so far it makes sense, right? So that is the first cycle they did the sequencing, okay? So you are reading one nucleotide for every single molecule you are trying to sequence. And then the next step is, remember we did two modifications. One is to add a stopper, the other one is to add the color, okay? So now cut both them off, okay? The stopper is getting rid of. It's a very simple, just an enzymatic reaction. And then the color, the fluorescent labeling is getting rid of. So now you are having a nucleotide just like normal. It's ready to go for the next one. And then next time, you do the same reaction, you put a lot of those color in there, so you see the previous one, it was a green. Now there is a red there, because the second cycle of this molecule is a T, so that's why A was being grabbed and put in there, okay? And then you take another picture. And then get rid of those two modifications again and again and again, right? So up to 150 cycles, and the reaction in our high seq takes about 3.5 days, but we are sequencing huge amount, and 2.5 billion of those molecules in this 3.5 days. Actually, 300 days, it's not 150. It's a 150 this side, 150 this side. So it's really a very, very powerful reaction. So you can see that this is that's the reason that I went into the trouble of explaining the Sanger sequencer reaction. This is, if you will, this is almost identical, right? Other than they make some modification to those nucleotides.
So it's still incomplete for a patient's genome because that's 3 billion base pairs, right?
Yes, absolutely. But the issue is that you are not sequencing one DNA molecule, right? So you got the patient the DNA, and there are so many, but you fragment it into smaller pieces. When we do the reactions, we'll explain how to do the DNA sequencing. You basically, you're not getting, I mean, chromosome 1 is like how big? It's like 140 megabase, 140 megabase is really long. You're not just dumping the DNA. You first cut the DNA into smaller pieces. It's like a 3 to 500 bases. So you have so many different smaller ones, and then you sequence from host to end. At the end of the day, you have the complete DNA. Okay? So now when you do the sequencing, so you see the first cycle, the picture being taken like this, and then the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, and then on and on. So you know that you just read the same spot, you know they are coming from the exactly the same nucleotide molecule.
Okay? And this is the ABI 3700,
and this is the summer sequencing instrument. And this is the workforce of the human genome project, right? So and this is a hold on. This is the picture of the Broad Institute during the human genome project era. And there's a lot of these machines are doing the sequencing, right? But I just told you the glass I showed you have 2.5 billion of this instrument that is built on it. And that is how the technology really evolved.
So this one is, I know it's a little small, and you don't have that in your slides. I just added it in. And this is the Illumina sequencer product line.
So it has a very, very small, starting from the mini-seq, and then MiSeq, NextSeq, HiSeq, X10 series, and NovaSeq. And this is the one that they are just being announced this year. And you can see the size become bigger and bigger, and the throughput become higher and higher, the cost become lower and lower. And our Center for Medical Genomics, and we have these two instruments, the NextSeq series and HiSeq series.
Okay, any question about the Illumina sequencer? Good. All right, so I'm quickly going through another technology that is of sleep.
The reason I want to do that is for two reasons. One is I still want to show you how smart they are, even they are asleep. And it's really fascinating how they design things differently to design this instrument. And the second is although they're asleep, their data are still out there. And in many cases, you probably have the opportunity to still see those data. And especially for implementations, so you want to rework on other people's data, and that's something you have to know. Okay, so the major difference between solid and Illumina is on both two ends in terms of the amplification and sequencing. And the amplification is called emulsion PCR, and the sequencing is called the sequencing by ligations. I'm going to go through this part very quickly because, basically it's obsolete. There is one thing I want to mention, and that the data is very complicated. And you can think of Illumina is you got the ACGT, and you just read ACGT out of those colors. It's very straightforward. Solid is not, and I will tell you why it is not. But what it does is it doesn't tell you. It also has four different colors, but blue doesn't mean it's ACG or T. Blue means it's AA dinucleotides, or CC, or GG, or TT, okay? And the green means it's either CA, or AC, or GET, or TG. So they have, four colors represent 16 dinucleotides. It becomes, makes things really, really complicated.
But they said it's good because for each base they sequence that they look at it twice.
So meaning that if your sequencing error is 1%, for example, and the chance you make two mistakes continuously is 1% of 1%. They're saying that. I've never seen that it was being realized. But so let's see, go through how they do that.
And the first one is the emulsion PCR. And this is important because this technology, emulsion PCR, is not only used in solid, but also used in the FOFA4 technology and then the M-proton technology.
So I'm not going to go through M-proton how they do things for the amplification part. But
So this is the emotion PCR. So what it does is it's a bead-based technology. So you can see that their components is like this bead has a lot of sequence adapters around. And then your library template is, it's also the ligation-based. So this blue part is the sequence you want to know what the sequence is. It's a template you want to sequence. And they have adapters on it. But long story short, what they want to do is, called emotion PCR, is they form certain reactions, and then they basically created those individual bubbles, okay? And for each bubble, they control the condition in the way there is only one beam plus one template and plus a bunch of adapters in the way. Okay? There are sometimes it's random reaction, you have to control the conditions. So some of them are having like this, have two sequences being trapped into that. Sometimes for the same, they have two beads trapped into it. It's okay. I mean, they are not going to be used. So there's a random cases, but the majority of them, they are controlling the condition in a way. In this bubble, there is only one bead, one sequence, and a bunch of adapters in play. And then the next reaction they do is they call the emotion PCR. So basically, they will do this PCR reaction using this one template is going to be put here. And using this as a template to do the amplification, but only on this bead, because all the adapters is kind of on this bead. Okay. So by the end of the day, what you got is for each individual one, initially you see it's an empty bead, and after that, they are having all those trees grow out, but with the same sequences. So around this speed. So one nucleotide will become about 30,000 nucleotides that are around this speed with exactly the same sequences. So that's what they do. And then at this point, that's what they do the amplification. They bridge all the bubbles and then everything will be mixed together. So that is the amplification procedure. It's not a bridge amplification, it's called the emotion PCR, okay? So it's a bead based and also the adipose based. It's basically a bubble based. And so I'm not going to go detail on this, but you can see that each individual bead now after this it become the, you got these adapters as well as the sequences are identical. And then they do some modifications and they put that all those amplified beads on those reactions and then go for the sequencing. Okay, so this is the amplification part.
I don't think I have the solid. I at one point we probably need to get a few of those. What is this?
Right. So that is amplification. It's an emotion PCR. Okay. And the next stage is after amplifier, we need to do the sequencing. So how to do the sequencing? It's completely different from the DDNTP and DNTP or those DNA synthesis based. This is called ligation based. So what they are using is these individual probes. Okay. And these probes are just the sequences and they're called probes. Just to confuse people who are not familiar with this, right? So what this probe is, you can see this is 8 bases probe. And this 8 base probe is going to have 5 nucleotides, T, C, N, and N stands for anything, right? So T, C, N, and those are the real nucleotides. And they have ZZZ, and these three, they are universal base, which means they can hybridize to anything, okay? And so that is a basic component of the probe. But they also have this cleavage site being built in. So at one point, if I add in certain enzyme, this part is going to be cut. And then you can see there is a color labeling in this part as well. Okay, towards the end. It's the fluorescent label. And then you can see that this is a TC, and they put yellow here. And if you look at this table, TC and it's yellow. Okay, so which color to put on this probe is simply due to depends on the first two nucleotides of the probe. So if the first nucleotide is TC, they will put the yellow, and the GA, they also put the yellow, but if it's GC, they will put the red. So it's a 16 different combinations, but four different colors. That is the probe, and we haven't done sequencing yet. That makes sense? Okay, so now let's see how they do the sequence. Now what you got is you got this bean, this is the adapter, and then the template. So what happens is you basically, you first you put the adapter, the sequence adapter here. And then the sequence adapter is basically reverse complement to this gray part, which is the small adapter on the bean, connecting meter to the bean. So after that will be your sequencing product that you want to sequence immediately starting from there. So what you do is you are throwing all those different probes into the environment, and then you got this reverse complement happen, okay, hybridized to here, and then you do the ligation. You see there's a ligase, it's an enzyme to connect them together. So you can see that initially there was just floating around and come here, but they are being ligated together. Okay? So that's the first step. All right? And then you take a picture. It's the same thing. Right? You take a picture. And then you see if this part is green, and that means it's corresponding to TA for the first two nucleotides. And then the next step is you're going to this image and take a picture part. And then next step, you do the cleavage. And remember, we have this cleavage site on the probe. You cut it and get rid of the color. Okay? And then you do this reaction again, but the first five base are your previous probe. And then starting from here, your new probe is going to come. So now you're sequencing this and this two bases. And then you do the ligase to ligate them together, take another picture. Okay? So now become this color that tells you these two nucleotides are whatever the sequences are. And then, so you do this towards the end again and again. So basically, you do the hybridization, ligation, cleavage, get rid of the picture, and cleavage, get rid of the color, and then do another one, and then get rid of it and do another one. So yeah, and towards the end. And then after that, you're done for part of the sequence, not all the sequence. And then next stage you do is you're going to reset and this the sequence. So basically get rid of everything that is being attached to it. And then you use another primer, which is the same as the previous one, with the difference that is one nucleotide short, okay? So now you see that the previous one, after you do it, and towards the end, it starts to become immediately the next, the sequence you want to sequence. But now we're doing is one nucleotide into the adapter. So the first nucleotide you are trying to sequence, first of all, you already know it. It's EACG or T because it's part of your adapter. And second, you're sequencing that as well. Okay? And then what you do is exactly the same reaction, doing this again and again and again. So while we're doing this, so you can see this table, right? So the first universal primer, that is what I was talking about. And then you sequence it. The first and the second base, you read a color. And then you do the cleavage, get rid of three nucleotides,
and then sequence these two, and then sequence these two, this two, this two, this one, until the end of the read. And then you use this n minus one primer, you sequence this one and this one, and this one and this one. So you see this pattern, and then you use another primer, and then you sequence this and this, this and this, and so on and so forth. If you look at this, each nucleotide is actually being sequenced twice. And that's why they're saying we're more accurate than Illumina, at least back in those days. Because when we make a mistake, if our sequencing error is comparable to Illumina, because every single base we're sequencing twice, so we are much less likely to make mistakes. But the problem of this scenario is, I mean, in theory, this is beautiful, everything is great, except for data analysis is so complicated. And there's no strict answer for a lot of variation that we were able to identify, and eventually that it really didn't make it, okay? So but that is the solid sequencer. And but what I need you to remember are two things. First, the amplification is the motion PCR, and versus the Illumina, that is the bridge amplification. Second, for the sequencing part, is sequencing by ligation, while for the Illumina, it's sequencing by synthesis. Okay? So that is the two differences about the technology. And the third difference is the data structure. And this is the so-called color space base, which is every two nucleotide has a color corresponding to it. Well, Illumina is a base space base, meaning that for A, C, D, G, T, they all have different colors. So there are three differences: amplification, the sequencing technology, and the data structure. Okay. So if in the exam I have a question like this, and I will expect you be able to answer it. Any questions so far? Okay, for the remaining technology, one slide for each. Okay, just to tell you the basic principle for the biochemistry. This is the 454 technology, it's also called parallel sequencing, but in terms of this, you can see that the amplification is still the emulsion PCR base, and you've got a bead and this nucleotide, and the chemistry they are using is based on the principle that when the polymerase put something on that, I mean, do this extension, and with certain chemicals they put in, and will release ATP. And then when the ATP is being captured, and they have something that is using this ATP to make power. Okay. So meaning that this is, in essence, it's still sequencing by synthesis. So you're still putting the nucleotide on, but every time you put one nucleotide on, instead of color labeling, you actually release some of the chemical to make that chemical shine. Okay, and then, so this is basically the principle. So you can see there are many different little spots there, and each one has a bead that drop into it. And then what we do is I will throw a lot of A to the system. So whoever is a P in my next nucleotide, and it's going to capture it to do the synthesis. And then that well is going to have an ATP, and that well is going to shut. So, and then you take a picture, you will see that which well is being lightened up. That means that part is a P because I throw A into it. After this, I throw C, whatever has a G is going to be lightened up. So this is kind of that type of scenario. It's very, very smart. And I see all these technologies, and it's really amazing. And so when I visited Roche,
and they have a poster, right? I mean, back in those, it was at least 6-7 years ago, and they are the competitor of Illumina, right? And now they are not doing this anymore. But they were the competitor of Illumina. They say, okay, we are not sequencing that much, and the Illumina throughput is way higher than 4.4. But they say, but our reads are longer, right? So they can, with this that reaction, they can go 400 bases. Now they can go 800 bases. So I saw a poster at this, and to say that if you want to play the puzzle, which one you want to play, right? So this one, so this, the picture have six different puzzles, and then this one, you have 400. So meaning that, well, if you want to challenge yourself, you want to play this, right? But if you really want to recover the original picture, then this will be much easier to do. So meaning we're sequencing long arrays, it'll be much easier to do the assembly and reconstruct what the genome looks like. Okay. So next technology is the Pacific Bioscience technology. And for this one, I mentioned this is part of the third generation sequencing technology. And this single molecule real-time becomes smart sequencing technology. So the general idea is, and you can read what that is, but it is nano-hole based. Okay, I'll tell you my understanding of it. So but it's very similar to the 4-file-4 I just showed you. But the difference is that they have a lot of different little holes. Each one is about 100 nanometers size. And then what they do is they have a polymerase sitting inside each hole. Okay? So like this. And this polymerase is modified in the way that if it grabs a DNA sequence using the template to synthesize, and then they are going to shut. Okay? So with this design, the interesting part is a single molecule, because you are not relying on the signal from that molecule, because the polymerase can make the color. And when they make the color, and then when you take the pictures, you'll be able to see it. So that's why it's a single molecule. So it's just the, and other than that, it's exactly the same principle as the 4x4. I'm putting in a lot of A, I'm going to see which hole start lighting up. If it lights up, that means there's a T there. Okay? And then I throw a lot of G there, and then I see which hole lighting up. Whatever lighting up, the next vector is C. So after you do this, again and again and again, and you will be able to sequence it. So the interesting part of this technology, I want to mention two more points. The first one is, I don't know how to do that. First one is very long reads. And as you can see, this is from 10 to 15K nucleotide. It's not a short read anymore. And sometimes they can go to even longer, 60,000 bases. And the second advantage, did I put it here? I didn't put it here. Is they can somehow read the methylated C as the fifth nucleotide. And which means they can directly measure the DNA methylation without modifying the DNA itself, which is a huge advantage. Anyway, that's the Pacific Bioscience. I mean, everything so far we're seeing is really, really smart. Next one is the unproton technology. Do I have it? Let me see.
Why did I probably don't have the proton, but we'll have the opportunity to see those
in the when we do the core review, core tour. So this one is a semiconductor-based technology, and the principle it's based on is nucleotide, and when the polymerase grab a sequence and to do the DNA extension, it will release a hydrogen ion, which is a proton. It will release a hydrogen ion. And this hydrogen ion is going to change the local pH value. Okay? So the way they do that is
you have so many little holes, and each one sitting in a bunch of molecules representing in fact the same molecule, DNA molecule. You can think of the bead-based technology, and then there are many molecules are identical to some. And then they were being put into each individual hole. Okay? And then you'll throw A onto it, and whichever has a T, there will be a lot of pH change. And that pH change is going to be detected by the semiconductor underneath it. Okay? So that is the basic principle of it. And another interesting fact of this technology is, you see, this is the first one we're talking about that are not taking a picture, right? And actually, those taking the picture part is why is the instrument itself is so expensive. And those cameras are a very high resolution camera and needs to be extremely stable. They are very, very expensive. And that's why their first instrument is like only $70,000 or $50,000. Compared to Illumina, it's $1 million or something like that. So that's why the instrument, the cost is different as well. So you can see that when the nucleotide, polymerase will do the extension, and when it gets the right nucleotide, will release a hydrogen ion that will change the local pH value. Okay? And so this is how they do it. So you can see the DNA sequence, the polymerase is working, and then you throw A, and then you just observe which one has a signal being detected. But you can see that some of them has a signal being detected. Others have double signal being detected or triple signal detected. Who can speculate why? Why there's a signal at a certain point, there's no signal, I understand there's no match, right? One nucleotide, one signal, that means that I see if I'm throwing A into it and there's a T, right? What, how come sometimes I'm seeing three times the signal? It's because there's, yeah?
So are you only extending by one base at a time, or can you extend by like two days?
Exactly. So what we are doing is that there's no stopper. So once you put an A, and if there's a three T's connecting together, it's going to be put in one A, after that, another A, another A. So that the same thing will have three protons being released. So you are seeing the differences in terms of the signal intensity. So when you look at observing three, that means there are three keys in continuous. Okay. And this is sometimes because, so I'm seeing the major issues of this technology is about homopolymer. So homopolymer is like a multiple nucleotide connecting with each other. And this is actually one of the reasons that they have this problem is that if you have zero or one, I can see that signal. If I have one versus two, I can see the signal. But if you have 10 versus 11, I mean, based on the signal intensities, I'm really not sure it's 10 or 11. So in a stretch of nucleotide of the same nucleotide, and they have a problem to identify exactly how many it is. But what the point I want to make here is you can see that this is also another very interesting, very smart technology that is based on a simple biochemistry observation, and then they take it off advantage to do the sequence. Okay? All right. So the last sequence that I want to get into a little bit, as I mentioned earlier, is called nanopore technology. So what it does is So I know that there's some biologists that learned some of the cell biology. So we know that the cell membrane is kind of bilayers, and then the inside and outside, they are only connecting through the transmembrane proteins, right? And the inside of the cell membrane, the outside of the cell membrane, their electrical velocity potential is different, right? That's how
our cells maintain its viability and then to switch different environments inside and outside of cells. This technology is using very similar principle. So you can see that there is a two layer of whatever it is. I mean, basically it's the ceiling of the top and bottom. And the top and bottom, the electrical potential is different. Okay? And then they put this molecule, they engineered this called nanopore, and just staking through it. So you can see that this nanopore molecule protein, there is a molecule can go through it. Okay? And while we do the sequencing, whatever you can read it, while we do the sequencing, so you can see there's another mechanism that grabs the DNA sequence just down through this hole. Okay? Because the A, C, G, T, they are all having different sizes. Okay? And then when the molecule going through, that will generate the electrical current. Right? And because of the ACGT has different sizes, and the electrical current it generates is different. Okay, so you can see some of them is bigger, and then you see major disruption. Smaller one, you see a less disruption. So by looking at the electrical signals that is going through this process, and you're going to get the sequences of this particular molecule. Does that make sense? Okay, it's not as easy as this that. Okay, go ahead.
So this membrane in a cell or is it by itself or is it like an artificial membrane? Or?
It's a so the way it does is actually it's a one membrane. It's not that big, it's the whole thing is about this size. So it's one membrane, and inside outside are different, and then they have many. I think a few thousand of these proteins that sit in the way. And each membrane, I mean, each nanopore is working through it, and they are being sealed. So you can only observe the local electrical signals. But each membrane is working, each protein is working independent, each pore is working independent.
I'm not saying that the human body has charge separation, that's what causes the difference.
Yeah. Right.
Where does this current take place? Is it a property of the membrane? Is it like where's this? So where's this current?
It's the constant flash of the signals, the electrical signals that going through the. So you can think of if there is nothing going through, there is a constant current that goes through, and then once you go in, and then the current will be changed. That makes sense? We can chat about it later. But one thing I want to mention is I'm saying in the way that ACGT1 really has a time that causing this disruption. Actually, it's not. And it's a 5 nucleotide stretch that will hold the entire this core and to impact the signal. And so each time they will have one nucleotide move, and then so the other five, and then another five, and to really, so that's why that when you see these signals, it's not like just a fine layer, so it can be pretty complicated. But by the end of the day, by analyzing this data, you will be able to see the sequences. Okay. And there's several different assays of this, but they were based on very similar experimental. The biochemistry behind it is the same. And for this technology, the interesting fact is they can generate a very, very, very long rate. And the sequencing quality is not deteriorating, which is great. So how long all this is, we have seen the data from several hundred thousand bases, okay? And I think that there is a one publication come out. They sequenced the entire E. coli genome with only 6
rates, and that they were able to sequence just that long of alpha molecule. So it's really amazing. So hundreds of the, and also there's the speed thing as well. So as I mentioned earlier, so when we go to the, so last time we, a month ago, I think we did a test doing this, using this sequencer. And we basically sequenced the not very important stuff. We sequenced a lot of DNA. And we fragmented the DNA of about average size of 3,000 bases. And by the end of the day, what we sequenced the read length, the average is 2,983. So it's almost it's sequenced the entire molecule for every single one of them. It's super impressive. There is a catch. The throughput is not that high. That's number one. Number two is the sequencing error is pretty high. It's about 10%. So if you use that to do the genotyping, don't do that. Okay. But if you use that to detect various infections, for example, and there is a way to do that. So as a matter of fact, you can see this is the article from The Guardian, and it said from Ebola to Zika, tiny mobile lab gives real-time DNA data on outbreaks. So as we all know that these sequencers are great, but they need a very sophisticated infrastructures, like the Illumina sequencing, you need the temperature and the humidity, and then you need a large server to support it. And it's not a cost, it's okay. We do it in the United States or in other developed countries, but it's not possible to do that in the middle of Africa during this outbreak of Ebola. So what they did for this group of investigators, they packed the six sequencers in their suitcase. They take on the plane and then went to Africa and do it. So there's a Nature article of this. As you can see, I put the pictures there. They don't even have electricity. they have this generator there, and a few either laptop or desktop, and then this is their environment. They just use this. They were able to detect the Ebola outbreak. So I'm pretty sure that many of you have seen this figure many times, right? So you know what that means. This is the time from 2001, that's the end of the Human Genome Project, to 2015, a couple of years ago. And this is the cost to sequence one megabase of DNA, what the cost is. And this is a lot transformation of the new cost. So you can see by 2001, if we sequence 1 million base, it will cost us about $8,000. And today, in my lab, it will cost about 2 cents to sequence that 1 million base DNA sequence. But if you look at this figure, I mean, of course, it's Moore's law, you can make a story out of it. But the point is, there are two things happen. One thing happened here. Okay? Somewhere in 2007, there's a significant jump. Okay? That's the year that Illumina started to have their first sequencer come on the market. Okay? And then there is a, and then there's another job. And this is the year that Illumina started to roll out their the X10 system. The X10 system to do the sequencing. It's really much higher throughput than what we are having, and which is much lower cost. With this curve going forward, I don't know, there's not a lot of room to jump, but I'm pretty sure there's another jump in 2017 this year, because earlier this year in January, Illumina started to roll out their NovaSeq, which they are targeting a $100 human genome, which is 10 times cheaper than what we are having right now. So I mean, there's a lot of things going on. So basically, if you look at this rapid decrease in the cost, we know that the first human genome project from 1990 to 2003, I mean, back in 1990, it's not too far away, right? It's 27 years ago, we don't know what are the sequences that define a human. So we don't know what is the human DNA sequence. And then Watson and a few other people, they started to say, okay, we need to sequence the human. They used 13 years, hundreds of labs in the world are working on that, and it cost us $3 billion, and we get one drop of human genome, right? And fast forward to 2007, using 4-5-4, they sequenced one individual's DNA genome, cost $2 million, and today, and the cost is about $1,000 to do the sequencing. And there is a further room to evolve of this. First is to sequence faster. Now we still need a couple of days. We can do that in 15 minutes, that would be amazing. And another one is to further to reduce the cost. Yes?
So we're talking about the sequencing time decreasing. What about like assembly time? Because don't we still need reference genomes when you have reads that short? If for like nanopore sequencing, which I can see how you would get away with that reference genome.
Mm-hmm. But so for the you can do the assembly pretty well using about 300 bases reads. And it's not going to cover everything. You'll still generate a lot of context. They are not very big sizes. I mean, you're perfect right. I think at a certain point we'll talk about that. So far, there is a general rule if you really need to do the genome assembly and to combine the PacBio or nanopore technology with the short read sequencing. So you got the framework as well as to fix the individual basis because those long reads are not very accurate.
Okay, these are where the machines are. Okay, and we need to take another 5 minutes break. I cannot talk 3 hours without stop. Okay, all right. We'll come back at 5:02 in my watch.
I agree. Well, the call that we want to stop.
Probably.